ज्ञानम परमम ध्येयम्, नॉलेज इज सुप्रीम।
So in the last couple of classes, we have introduced the concept of the use of the rigid rotor model to understand rotation of diatomic molecules. And we have kind of told you without explaining too much what the spectrum would look like. So today what we intend to do is to try and understand what the origin of that selection rule delta J equal to plus minus is. To do that, first thing we need to do is recapitulate a little bit of the quantum mechanics of a rigid rotor. Well, you already discussed some part of it, but I think we should recapitulate. To start with, the quantum mechanics of the rigid rotor is exactly the same as the treatment of the angular part of the wave function for a hydrogen atom, right? Even before that, what we do essentially when we have a two-body problem like a rigid rotor, we reduce it to a one-body problem. How do we do it? By considering one particle of reduced mass rotating around a massless center with a radius equal to radius of gyration. For a diatomic molecule, this radius of gyration is equal to the bond length, all right? And when we do that, we understand that the only parameters that can change if we think in spherical polar coordinates are the angular parameters. R is fixed, right? R is equal to your length of the molecule. So this is a problem which you can express if you take the two angular coordinates theta and phi. I hope all of us remember what theta is, what phi is. Yeah, what is theta? Let us say your x, y and z axis, and let us say this is a position vector or some vector. Then what is theta? The angle between z axis and this vector, right? And what is phi? If you drop a perpendicular on the xy plane, then the angle between x axis and the projection on the xy plane of the vector, that is phi, okay. So if the length of this vector, let us say is mu, I say mu because we are going to use the angular, the dipole moment vector in no time. If the length is mu, then what is the z component of mu? Mu z, that is equal to what? That is equal to shake of the head. Let us say this is x axis, y axis, z axis. This here, let us talk about the angular moment, dipole moment vector, since we are going to talk about it anyway, mu. What we are saying is this angle between the z axis and mu is your theta. So if you drop a perpendicular here, what is the z component? This is mu cos theta, right? That essentially is mu z, all right? To get the x and y components, we drop a perpendicular on the xy plane. What is the length of this vector? Mu sin theta, of course, okay. Let us call this mu 0. So then this becomes mu 0 cos theta. I do not even have to write the arrow. This is mu 0 sin theta. And then if this angle is phi, then if what is this x coordinate? Length is mu 0 sin theta. Multiplied by cos phi or sin phi? Cos phi, very good. And what about the y component? So, this is what? This is equal to mu x. And what about this? What is mu y? Length once again is mu 0 sin theta, right? Multiplied by sin theta, sin phi. So, you know right away what are the x, y and z components. You know this already, but sometimes we forget. So, I thought it is better to recapitulate once. Y mu, we will see in a moment. Okay. Now, coming back to the rigid rotor, the wave function is a function of the two angular coordinates theta and phi is given by, I am not going to write the entire expression, you do not need to remember this, right. I will write it in a little cryptic notation, it is enough if you can understand that. Okay, some constant that I am going to write as n is actually something like j plus mod m plus 1 divided by j minus mod m. You do not need to remember such long expressions. So, I just write like this. This is the normalization constant, and as we know, how many quantums are associated with rotational motion? 2. What are the 2? J and m, right? What does J stand for? Total angular momentum, right? And what does M stand for? Yeah? Z component of the angular momentum. Of course, as you know, quantum numbers arise out of solution of different parts of Schrodinger equation. Here, Schrodinger equation would be described in terms of two coordinates theta and phi. So, does J come from theta part or phi part? Does M come from phi part or theta part? What? We do not know this? Are we sure we do not know this? Go back to hydrogen atom problem. From the phi part, I have heard you. Wait, let us see if others can respond. In hydrogen atom problem, where did the magnetic quantum number small m come from? Theta part or phi part? Phi part. So, this capital M is the same as small m. We are just writing it differently because it is not hydrogen atom problem. It is a rigid rotor problem. Okay? So, this also comes from the phi part. This comes from the theta part. J, if you remember, is equivalent to small l for hydrogen atom. Okay? And when we talk about change in phi, what does it mean? Change in phi means, let us say this is z, x, y, phi means this angle, right? If you have rotational motion in like this, what will be the direction of the resultant angular momentum? If this is the direction of rotational motion, like this, right? Right? I hope you remember this. Perpendicular to the plane of the orbit. Okay? So, J and M. So, what I will do is, I will erase this. And write this expression. This n will be a function of J as well as M. That will be multiplied by the theta part. That then it will be multiplied by the phi part. As we have discussed earlier, theta part is this polynomial in cos theta. This polynomial, as we have discussed in the previous class, is called associated Legendre polynomial. And the point to note is that the polynomial is in cos theta and not theta, point number one. Point number two is that what the polynomial will look like determines not only on J, but also on mod m. Mod m multiplied by e to the power I m phi. We are going to need this. So, for a given value of J, how many different wave functions am I going to have? For a given value of J, how many different wave functions will I have? Will I have one wave function per j or will I have many? Will I have many? How many? 2j plus 1. And where does this 2j plus 1 comes from? It comes from the number of values of capital M. Okay? Will these 2j plus 1 levels have same energy or different energy? Same energy. What is energy? Epsilon j, if I write in centimeter inverse, is given by b j into j plus 1. Is that right? What is b? H divided by 8 pi square mu r 0 square c. This mu is reduced mass. That is why I wanted to write mu 0 there. Otherwise, this mu and that mu would have created some problem. So, this is b. In this expression, there is no contribution of capital M, isn't it? No contribution of capital M. So, energy is determined only by capital J. As we know, each J is associated with 2J plus 1 values of capital M. So, all these levels are going to be of same energy. So, each J level is 2J plus 1 fold degenerate. All right. Now, what are we trying to do here? Why are we invoking so much of quantum mechanics? What we are trying to do is, we are trying to understand which transitions in for this rigid rotor are going to be allowed, which transitions for the rigid rotor are not going to be allowed. You already know the answer, delta j equal to plus minus 1. How do we get that? If I ask a more general question, what is it that determines whether a transition is allowed or not? The answer is transition moment integral, which is integral psi f star mu psi d tau, that must be equal, that must be non-zero for the psi I to psi f transition to be allowed. This integral here is called transition moment integral, and in order for a transition from psi I to psi f, I for initial, f for final, to be allowed, this transition moment integral must be non-zero. Do you all know this? Well, I have said it just now, so you know it now, even if you didn't know it earlier. How do we get to this? For that, we will need to wait a couple of weeks. For now, please believe me that this is the condition. But then we are going to derive this as well from time-dependent perturbation theory. For now, let us just take it axiomatically that condition for a transition psi I to psi f to be allowed is that this transition moment integral must be non-zero. Okay? Before we start working out the selection rule for rigid rotor, two more things need to be remembered. First is, what is d tau? For spherical polar coordinates, what is this volume element d tau? Gurjot, if I am working with x, y, z, Cartesian coordinates, then I know very well that this d tau or dv, whatever you want to call it, is dx into dy into dz, right? If I am working with r theta phi, what is this d tau or dv? R square. Let us finish writing the r terms first, r square dr, then sin theta d theta d phi. Excellent. Do we all know this? And do we know how we get this? It is not very difficult, right? So, it is very easy to get it using geometry, relationship between Cartesian and spherical polar coordinates. Apparently, it is easier if you use a Jacobian. But then I do not know what a Jacobian is, so I cannot do it. Some of you might be able to. All right. So, this is what it is. We are going to need this expression for volume element in our subsequent discussion. Now, last point that we will need to use is this. This e to the power I m phi is pretty straightforward, right? But this polynomial looks a little intriguing to us. But the reason why we write it in this polynomial form is that this associated Legendre polynomials are not unrelated to each other. They are related to each other in a very nice fashion. There are three different rules that relate polynomials of a series, right? And these are called recursion relations. A recursion relation means you can express a polynomial as a linear combination of the polynomial before it and the polynomial after it. So, recursion relations for associated Legendre polynomials go like this. First, if you take a polynomial like this, a polynomial for j and the value of m is value of mod m is given, right? And let us say this polynomial is in terms of some variable z. Take this polynomial and multiply it by z, you get something like a1 p j plus 1 mod m of z plus a2 p j minus 1 mod m z. A1 and A2 are constants. Once again, these are constants that are made up of the values of J, M and some numbers. We do not need to know what A1 is, what A2 is. In the exam, if I need to use the explicit value of A1, A2 or whatever else I am going to write now, then it will be provided. So, please do not worry about mugging up the expressions, mugging up the expressions for the coefficients. It is not required. Okay. If you need them, they will be provided. But this is something that you will need to know. But this is very straightforward, right? It is not very difficult. Okay. Second one, are you aware of these recursion relations? Yes? What is the second one then? Yeah? I will write the right hand side. B1 P J plus 1 mod m of z plus b2 p j minus 1 mod m of z. And in fact, there is a third one, I will write that as well. C1 p j plus 1 mod m of z plus c2 p j minus 1 mod m of z. So, right hand side is essentially the same, right? Linear sum of the polynomial before, polynomial after with no change in m. What are the left hand sides? Do you know this or no? Then say that, I will write it, it is okay. So, left hand side what you have is, in one case you have pj mod m plus 1 of z. In the other case you have pj mod m minus 1 of z, and it is multiplied by square root of 1 minus z square. This is also multiplied by square root of 1 minus z square. So, these two are little more complicated than the first one, but nothing that should actually scare us, all right.